Welcome to our daily podcast, The News Around Uganda. It's the 17th of May 2021. I'm Lydia Lekwonyero. In our first story, Parliament is today expected to start swearing in new members. The function starts today and shall run up to the 28th of this month, and thereafter members shall elect the Speaker and Deputy Speaker. According to the statement issued earlier by the Parliament Communication Department, MPs elect are expected to follow the COVID-19 standard operating procedures. Meanwhile, traffic police have issued guidelines advising motorists who are not part of the swearing-in ceremony to avoid roads around Parliament. According to a statement issued by the Kampala Metropolitan Traffic Police Commander Norman Musinga, members of Parliament shall only use one vehicle and access Parliament through King George and park at the National Theatre. Musinga says there are diversions in areas surrounding Parliament where Parliament Avenue is cut off at Kimathi Avenue and has warned against parking on roadsides. Relatedly, the Minister for Information, Judith Nabakova, has asked the new legislators to adhere to the set traffic guidelines and observe the COVID-19 standard operating procedures.
I know the PRO for Parliament has been speaking about the swearing-in ceremony on all platforms, telling people what they are expected to do. And they are given the traffic guidelines, security guidelines. We just expect the MPs who are coming in to follow the SOPs and guidelines as provided to them.
Still in the news, President Yoweri Museveni, who is also the chairperson of the ruling National Resistance Movement Party, has summoned the party's top organ today to deliberate on guidelines for electing speakers at various levels. The clerk to Parliament set May 24th as the day for the election of the Speaker and Deputy Speaker of the 11th Parliament at Kololo Independence Grounds, where Jacob Ulanya, the Deputy Speaker, is expected to run against his boss, Rebecca Alitwala Kadaga, for the speakership position. The party's Director for Communication, Emmanuel Dombo, confirmed the development, noting that several other issues will be discussed by SEC members. He adds that members who will attend the meeting at State House Entebbe have already taken COVID-19 tests.
What has been evident is that the regulations for the selection or election of the speakers at the local government level, at national level, are likely to be discussed in preparation for eventual other meetings that may discuss more important issues. And once the meeting ends, and has come up with a conclusive outcome that the public should know, it will definitely be notified through the usual formal channels, as we have always done.
Moving on, Center for Constitutional Governance wants Parliament to enact a law which provides for the transition of power from one government to another. Last week, on Tuesday, the Speaker of the 10th Parliament, Rebecca Kadaga, dissolved Parliament ahead of the swearing-in ceremony of President Yoweri Museveni on Wednesday, following the expiry of the tenure of government. The Executive Director for Center for Constitutional Governance, Sarah Birete, says currently it's only the President who is occupying the political office legally, and if such a loophole in the law is not addressed, it may create a leadership vacuum in the future.
So basically, the only person occupying a political position in this country today is President Museveni. The ministers who are still occupying offices are doing so illegally. The ministers in possession of government vehicles, they are holding them illegally and they should have handed over. In the absence of a law on transition, the president, after swearing in, should have issued an instrument allowing his old cabinet to continue until Parliament is in place to approve a new cabinet that is going to appoint. So Parliament should enact a law on transitions to provide for continuity, especially where we will be having a new president coming in to take over from the old, so that there is no vacuum in between the period for swearing in.
Meanwhile, more than 60 poachers in Kamwenje district have denounced the practice and surrendered their tools to Uganda Wildlife Authority. This was done at Bigodi Town Council during a training Uganda Wildlife Authority undertook with the Kabale National Park. During the training, former poachers were given skills in craft making so they can get an alternative source of income. The poachers, headed by George Ndiomugabe, said they have been carrying out poaching activities since their childhood, but revealed they had seen enough in poaching and that the challenges in the practice had outweighed the benefits. According to Oyesigide, the Uwa Conservation Officer, poaching cases skyrocketed in the lockdown, with 60 cases registered in Kibale National Park alone. These were also given farming inputs like beehives, pigs and goats to enable them get a source of livelihood. Moving on, more than 30,000 livestock farmers in the Northeast region have been asked to provide accurate data to the government ahead of the National Livestock Census due this month. This was issued by Dr. Robert Ojala, the Regional Veterinary Inspector in the Ministry of Agriculture for Northeast Region, in an exclusive interview with our reporter. He says the correct data will help the government to plan for veterinary services for the livestock in the country, calling on farmers not to shy away with the information because it will be kept confidential.
I want to tell the public that this activity is planned by UBOS in collaboration with Ministry of Agriculture, Animal Industry and Fisheries. I want also to tell the public that livestock census has been conducted in this country before. It was conducted in 1963, stock 65. It was also conducted in 1990, stock 91. And then the latest was 2008. So livestock census is not new. We actually conduct it every after 10 years.
Also in the news, Moses Atan Okia, the Member of Parliament elect for Soroti City East Division, has reiterated his commitment to empower constituents economically as a way of eradicating poverty in households. His statement comes virtually hours to his swearing-in ceremony. Atan notes that he has a role to ensure that his constituents are accorded the service they need through his personal and government programs.
The challenges that are ahead of us, we see many gaps in the health sector, in the education sector, in the poverty which has ridden our people, and the challenge of security with regard to our children, the street children. I've had engagements and talked to the street children. They are not there by desire. Most of them are from broken families. Most of them have run to find a meal in the streets of this city.
Meanwhile, there was exchange of bitter words between farmers and veterinary doctors due to failed control of foot and mouth disease in Nyabushozi County in Chiruhura District. This was during a meeting the farmers had with veterinary officials, whom they accused of increasing the spread of foot and mouth disease in the sub-county. The meeting was held at Ruempogo Church of Uganda in Nyabushozi. The farmers complain of the dwindling income that they've been getting from their livestock products. They add that stopping them from selling milk from sick cows as a last resort has also hit them hard. Farmers also disclose that milk prices have reduced from 800 shillings per litre to 400 shillings and 300 shillings, which is blamed on poor standard of milk being produced. Apparently, over 600 cows have been reported dead due to the foot and mouth disease in Ruempogo, Nyakashashara and Sanga in Nyabushozi in Chiruhura District. Still in the news, the National Drug Authority has arrested 7 veterinary officers after they were found in possession of illegal drugs for anti-foot and mouth disease. The suspects are qualified veterinary officers who were picked up from Besigwa Vet Drug Shop and Genakal Pharmaceuticals in Kazo Town during a joint security operation. Dr. Jean Mohindo, the head of the veterinary products in the National Drug Authority, says that foot and mouth disease has no drug, but people are using the current situation to fleece farmers of their money.
As we're in the field, we came to know that there is a product which is called anti-FMD, which is claimed to have even been advertised in Chiruhura, Rushere, and they were promoting the use of this product purported to be drug that treats the FMD wounds. And on assessing the product very well, the product was not registered by NDA, and neither does it have indication or does it show that it is really able to treat the FMD effects. And if you assess it very well, you see that somebody was purporting a drug either to fleece the public of money in pretending to give a solution to the problem.
Mohindo says the team also managed to recover 5 boxes of fake anti-foot and mouth disease drugs.
NDA in this operation has been able to recover 5 boxes of anti-FMD in quantities of 100 grams and 1 kilograms, which they were selling at between 70 and 75 Ugandan shillings. And they were indicating that the farmer should be giving this powder from morning to evening. And as you know, FMD, if an animal gets down, definitely you treat the symptoms symptomatically by giving in antibiotics and also washing the wounds with some products like hydrogen peroxide. But you could see that they were fleecing the public, and we are also able to arrest 7 persons in this operation.
Meanwhile, Arua Hospital is overwhelmed by cesarean operations amid space challenges. the hospital serves about 13 districts in West Nile region. The source reveals that due to the lack of space at the labor ward, mothers undergoing cesarean operations are mixed with normal deliveries, and as a result, some of them are admitted on the floor, which has resulted into increased infection rates. The source further reveals that due to drug stockouts at the facility, many patients are referred to purchase medicines in private health facilities. Oli Health Center 4, that has been operating at a capacity of a district hospital, has suspended cesarean deliveries at night due to lack of reliable power. The health facility depends on solar light at night, thereby causing more burden on the regional health facility. Meanwhile, leaders from West Nile have been implored to fast-track regional projects so as to accelerate integration and improve the livelihoods of citizens. During his inauguration speech on Wednesday, President Yoweri Museveni emphasized the need to deal with issues of regional and continental integration in order to unite the regional and continental markets to support production of goods and services better. However, for some people in West Nile region, economic integration cannot work if the frontline leaders have no political goodwill and are not united. Moses Akuna, the executive director of West Nile Development Association, says leaders have failed to cooperate and act with a sense of urgency so as to iron out the outstanding issues that undermine the integration agenda in the region.
Are our leaders acting collectively? Are we integrated, especially members of parliament? Are we acting collectively on issues that affect the development of our sub-region or the issues that affect the development of our country? Look at our LC5s. Are we acting collectively? Is there integration? Are we coming together?
The Uganda People Congress Party Vice President Titia Caleb Kamura says lack of unity from some leaders will cause disintegration in West Nile region in the long run.
President Museveni is talking big about integration, but see what is happening at home. You call all the LC5 chairmen, say there is a meeting in Arua. The one in Moyo will say, I also have a boardroom. The one in Koboko will say, I also have a boardroom. If you cannot integrate yourselves in the region, West Nile, the way the politics of Uganda is done, demands and requires the region of West Nile to work as a team. But today they are failing to work as a team, and it has been prepared that way.
The National Resistance Movement Party publicist in Arua, Boniface Alioni, says President Museveni has created an environment that is stable for economic development. Moving on. His Holiness Pope Francis has announced the establishment of the Lay Ministry of Catechists worldwide, saying the role played by catechists is one of the specific form of service among others within the Christian community. This is contained in his papal message delivered at St. John Lateran Church in Rome on the 10th of May 2021 on the liturgical memorial of St. John of Avila. Pope Francis invited the Episcopal Conference to render effective the ministry of catechists, determining the necessary process of formation and devising the appropriate forms for which catechists can stand to fulfill their duties. He noted that the Congregation for Divine Worship and Discipline of Sacraments will soon publish the Rite of Institution of the Lay Ministry of Catechists. And with that story, we come to the end of the news around Uganda. I am Lydia Lakonyero. Good day.